All right, guys, so welcome to the video. We're here with Macy Medford. She's a lawyer here in New York City. So we're gonna do like a day in the life type of atmosphere and also get to know like her style, because besides from a lawyer, she's got style, so
thank you.
Blow it away.
Hi, everyone, I'm Macy. I've been living in New York for about 5 years now. Just graduated from law school, passed the bar, and am finally working as an attorney. So excited for you to see kind of a day in my life, what that looks like. But you know, it's New York City, every day is different.
All right, guys, so we just made it to Cardozo, did I say it right?
Cardozo, yep.
School of Law here in New York City. So this is where Macy went to school, but tell us a little bit about it.
Obviously, this is, like you said, the law school Cardozo. It was named after the Supreme Court Justice Benjamin N. Cardozo, who you might not have heard of, or you have, but that we read many cases that he decided or wrote very detailed opinions about. One thing that you might have heard about Cardozo from is they started the Innocence Project, which is a really big deal and something that you see on Dateline 2020. They bring it up quite a bit. But the reason that I came to Cardozo is it has a great entertainment law program, specifically in music. So when I was looking up law schools, I looked up where some of music's highest powered lawyers went. And so many of them went to Cardozo, and I knew that I just had to go there. So not only did I get a lot of experience in music internships, I worked at Atlantic Records, Spirit Music Group, which is a publishing company, but I also took a lot of music and entertainment law classes that I still use today, such as music law, intellectual property licensing and drafting. I took copyright, got experience with trademark and fashion law, so many different things that I still use today.
Here we are. We done made it to Mace's apartment. What we got?
Welcome to Chelsea. So get excited, it's your quintessential New York apartment, starting with a 5-story walk-up. Door number one, security.
Up the stairs we go.
This is where you get your mail?
That's where I get my mail.
Cute little mailboxes.
And next story, you're gonna see my trash and the laundry room, which I'm very blessed to have.
That's the essentials, the essentials.
Yes, this is me. This is a New York delicacy is not the right word, but it's a delicacy.
There she is.
Gorgeous. I could cry. And here's where the real fun starts.
Smells amazing. How is this? You said you were on crutches earlier?
Yes, I tore my ACL 2 years ago. So I got to learn how to come up these stairs. How to crutch up these stairs.
Woo!
We made it!
Fifth floor. There we go.
Just kidding. All right. The main event. Welcome to my apartment.
Casita, casita.
That's Daisy. She runs this apartment.
So, hi, the baby. Sweetest.
Hi, baby girl.
You come on back. You have the kitchen bathroom.
We love
kitchen.
At least you have gas.
Yes, and a dishwasher.
Sweet.
I am blessed. Finally, the living room slash Woo! Office.
This is where she puts all the time and all the work. This is the war room.
Yes.
X.
Keep my friends up here. Keep it homey. Here's Daisy's corner.
Cute, cute.
I know. I am also very lucky to have two closets. We're not going to look in there, but just know that I'm very lucky to have this closet and one in my room.
Hey, storage for the clothes is the most important because you know we gotta be dripping out here in the streets, baby.
I also have a skylight, which brings in a lot of light, which is nice because some New York apartments have like, are a box without windows. But I even have a skylight. So usually, I could probably not be able to be in this apartment when I originally moved to New York with some of my musical theater friends. But
when they left during COVID, I managed to get a great COVID deal here. Locked it down for 2 years, and so I've gotten to stay here since.
So for those people that are coming to New York to be lawyers, where would you say is realistic to live?
I would say parts of Brooklyn. I also looked in the Upper East Side. The Upper East Side has some nice apartments. It really depends on if you have roommates or not. And because all of my friends had left for COVID reasons, it was just me. And so finding an apartment for one person can be really difficult, but obviously I was able to do it.
There she go.
I know.
Alright guys, so now we're in Macy's apartment. We're going to do a little Q&A and also talk about her casita. But we also have some student questions from the University of Texas at Austin. I don't go to school there, but I do live on campus. So there's plenty of lawyers that I run into when I'm studying. So I told them that I have the joy and pleasure of interviewing Macy Medford. So here we go. What's the cost of going into law school? What's that look like?
It looks like a lot of student loans is what it looks like. I think in general, law schools tend to be about $60,000 a year. Mm-hmm. And law school is also generally 3 years. Sometimes certain schools will do part-time law school, some will do night classes, but usually they require that it be full-time, especially your 1L, your first year. Mm-hmm. About $60,000 no matter where it is. Surprisingly, even if it's a state school, some have different costs, but yeah, it really looks like a lot of student loans.
So even if you're going to like New York versus just say like a random state that nobody wants to go to, you'd say like that tuition is kind of the same.
The way that it was, at least when I was looking, which was right at the start of COVID, early 2020, They were generally about $60,000 a year.
Gotcha. So you mentioned earlier like why you picked Cardona or
Cardozo.
I think Cardona is like a venture capital like investment, but
okay.
So Cardozo, why did you select, like, go over that again? And why you selected that school versus? And I'm sure there's plenty of other schools in the area.
Sure. When I started looking at law schools, let me go back to the beginning.
Okay.
So when I was a freshman in college, in undergrad, I went to Belmont in Nashville. Mm-hmm. I started going to the Grammys. I was a Grammy voting member. One of the things that I got to do during Grammy week was go to the Entertainment Law Initiative, ELI, brunch. And the first year that I went, they were honoring Julie Swidler. And she is one of the heads of Sony. And she had gone to Cardozo. And that was my first introduction to what Cardozo was. I had not heard of Cardozo. You know, I'm from Texas. I hadn't heard of this law school in Union Square up here in New York. And that was before I even knew that I would move to New York.
Yeah. She planted that seed.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And then I was looking through the program, and I saw that many of the other attorneys that were being honored also went to Cardozo. So that was kind of that like first seed of like, okay, I should probably check out the school. Mm-hmm. Granted, at that time, I was still planning on being an artist, continuing that part of my journey. I wasn't really thinking about going to law school yet, but it was kind of always a part of my life just because I loved to read so much. I liked watching lawyers on shows, and I thought maybe if being an artist didn't work out, it would be something I would be interested in doing. So with that being said, I continued going to the Entertainment Law Initiative brunches, getting to know these lawyers, and so Cardozo was always in the back of my mind. Then my senior year of undergrad, I thought to myself, you know, what if I am really interested in law? Maybe I should take a law class while I have some time. I had a bit of an open schedule because I had transferred, or I had come into school with some AP credits. So I had some free time my senior year. So I took an intro to law class and I did really well. I got an A, even though I had no idea what was going on. Like the first half of that class, I ended up kind of understanding what the fundamentals of the law were. And so I was like, oh, this is maybe something I would actually be good at. So I, without studying, which I do not recommend doing, I just decided one day, my final semester of undergrad, to take the LSAT. I was like, I just want to know what it's like, what it's about. Didn't even know the sections of the LSAT, didn't know anything. And I took it, and I got a score. Nothing to write home about, but it was a score. And I just kind of had that in my back pocket. So when I moved to New York, it was originally to audition. Continue singing, continue acting, just really be where entertainment is.
Yeah.
And I had a good 6 months of auditioning, got my first off-Broadway callback, like things were going, what I considered to be great, and COVID hit. And everything shut down, and I was just like, what am I going to do? I can't sit here and keep waiting for auditions to open back up. So I used that LSAT score, applied to Cardozo.
In the back pocket.
I kept it in my back pocket, and ended up going to law school way sooner than I thought I would, but was definitely the right decision for me, and I haven't looked back since.
Gotcha. So with that school, like, since it's so prestigious and hearing all these people that are attending, graduating, what do they look for in, like, an applicant that wants to go to a school that's that prestige?
I think because my LSAT score wasn't anything to write home about necessarily, I think they looked at my GPA. I had a really strong GPA from undergrad. Mm-hmm. And I think they also really looked at my personal statement, which was talking about how I had been an artist and I knew exactly what kind of lawyer I wanted to be.
Yeah.
I think there was some intrigue there.
Yeah, you're intentional with your decision.
Right.
For sure.
Exactly. I didn't look like I didn't know what I wanted out of law school. Yeah. I knew exactly what I wanted. And
I like girls that know exactly what they want as well.
Okay.
So, yes.
There you go.
There we go.
I think they really were intrigued by my personal statement and also knew that entertainment was something they focused on.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess in the end decided I would be a good addition.
Another question from one of the students was, what was the best way, because you just said you didn't study that much, but what was, to the best of your ability, what was the best way you prepared for law school?
The best way I prepared for law school.
Just a brief summary.
Well, to be clear, I would very much so recommend studying for the LSAT and getting the highest score that you can. Not only for you, but for scholarships. You know, that's something that they look at is your LSAT score. And if I had had more time to prepare, I definitely would have.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, really, I was so unprepared. I had no idea what I was doing. I got into the school, I think it was August, and was in classes by the end of August. I got in like August 4th and started classes, I think, somewhere around the 16th. What helped me prepare was meeting people beforehand. So in law school, you get placed in a section, which means that they're going to determine like what your schedule is. Everybody's taking the same core classes, right? I wasn't taking music and entertainment at that time. Because you're not allowed to yet in 1L. So what I did to get prepared was meet as many people as I could in my section, just chatting them on Facebook, making group chats, reaching out, seeing if anybody wanted to maybe be in a study group, if anybody had parents that were lawyers that knew more about law school than I did.
Mm-hmm.
And I just met as many people as I could, so I felt prepared walking into the school on day one. when I had no idea what was going on. I already had friends I could sit with and talk about this wild ride that we were on together. And I definitely think getting to know people early on was the best thing that I could have done.
Gotcha. And so, like, making friends or, you know, even associates, and then you were saying, like, hey, are your parents or even, are they lawyers? Did you find yourself finding a mentor or not really?
That's interesting. I had a mentor in a sense, in that after those ELA, entertainment law initiative brunches that I talked about, I had reached out to some of those attorneys, mm-hmm. and just kind of gotten, I got a little bit of a lay of the land from them. They let me know that it was a great school. They would be kind of on the lookout for my resume, yeah. and just gave me a few pointers before going into school. So even though they weren't like directly my mentors, mm-hmm. we had only met a few times, just keeping in contact through LinkedIn, email, those kind of things.
Even like emailing questions if you had any.
Yeah, absolutely. For sure. And one thing I learned in law school and before law school was it's awkward to reach out to people that you want to learn from, because you're like, wow, this person works at Universal, you know? And a lot of the times you won't get a response. They're busy. Maybe they don't even see it. But the few times that they do are so important for your whole journey. And those people that I started following before law school, just even knowing the path that they took and being able to see through their LinkedIn or from their bios helped me plan my path. Mm-hmm. What classes I thought I should be taking, who I should meet, what kind of internships I could get. So really just studying the paths of others. And if you can get a mentor, I would definitely recommend it. And I think it's also important on the other side, knowing where I am now, my goal is to helping other young lawyers or other young people that want to maybe be on the same path.
For sure.
And just give back the way that people have to us.
Exactly. You mentioned internships. Mm-hmm. So when you were in law school, what internships did you do? What did that look like?
So I decided, like we talked about very early, that connections were going to be really important for me, for what I wanted to do. Some people have a different experience in law school where they really focus on their grades, doing things called journals, which can be really good for certain jobs. But I had to decide early on, like, where am I going to put my energy? And I decided for myself, the best place would be internships. Mm-hmm. But you really have to decide, of course, for yourself and what career path you want to be on, what you think is the most beneficial. And for me, it was internships. So after my first year, I interned with 1RPM. They are a record label as well as kind of distribution company. And that was my first taste of working in the real world, like the real world as a lawyer in music. Of course, it was COVID, so it was all online and a very different experience, not being able to meet people in person. Mm-hmm. But after that, after my 1L summer, in 2L, I went to Spirit Music Group, which is a publishing company, and I got to work for them. Granted, to be clear, most of these internships were for free. It was one of those sacrifices that I had to make to be in this specific industry. And that's not always something that can be, that people are always able to do. So I was very lucky that I was able to take those opportunities.
And have that mentality.
Yeah, absolutely. Cool. And have that, like, I'm going to make this work, right?
For sure.
I worked at Spirit Music Group. Then I worked at a law firm that next summer called Morris Music Law. They were in L.A. So I actually flew out to L.A. To meet everybody at the firm, which was a totally different experience than working what we call in-house, right, at a publishing company, at a record label. There I had many more clients. We had multiple clients calling a day, where if you work in-house, your client is where you work, who you work for. If you work for Atlantic Records, then that's your client. So it was a new experience having a bunch of clients in that way. After I worked at Morris Music Law, I worked at Atlantic Records, my 3-0.
We'll visit.
Yes, yes we will. One of the best experiences of my life. Absolutely loved it.
I'm excited to
go I'm excited to go back. And then after that, I worked at another law firm called Boyarsky Fritz, my final semester of law school. And once again, got a whole different experience in the same area of law, in music, entertainment. But what I was doing every day was quite different. So I would suggest getting as much experience as you can while you're in school, because people are really willing to help you when you're a student.
For sure.
When you don't necessarily have anything that you want from somebody. You're not asking for to be paid or like for a job. But just setting aside that time, if you're able to intern, even if it's for free, I think was probably the best thing I did.
Which is showing you like your drive, like
absolutely,
to get to where you want to be. So
they know it's a sacrifice.
For sure. And so to wrap things up, like what would you say your best little gem of advice for everybody watching?
Oh, my best gem of advice. My best gem of advice is to study hard in law school, but at least for me and for a lot of my friends, the most important part of law school was meeting people and making connections. So there were times that there were happy hours or events that other schools were putting on where they'll have people come and speak about different areas of the law. And you're tired, you had a long day at school, you probably went to your internship and you just want to go home. But making that extra effort to go to that thing and stay after and meet people has made all the difference. Just getting face to face with people, later going on LinkedIn and connecting with them. I mean, that's how I've gotten jobs, you know, and getting your name out there, even in a city as huge as New York.
Yeah.
I'm starting to know people. I know who I can go to ask questions. And that network is how you will continue to work. I think it's more important than grades, but keep those up too if you can.
Net worth is the network?
I have not heard that, but I'm going to start using it.
Net worth is the network, so you definitely got to know people, because I'd say I'm in the same boat. Even, you know, her brother Grayson, we're always trying to connect with other people, so yeah, that's Macy's gem for the day. So now we're going to go to, where are we going?
We're going to 235th. It's a rooftop bar, and I'm going to call it the rooftop bar.
Nah, I love me a good rooftop bar. Did you love that one? But
we'll take you along with us. Here she goes. First time on the train station?
28th and Broadway.
There we go.
We're heading up to Times Square to see where I work and a few places I have worked.
This includes
on the R train. Not a train I take too often, but a train nonetheless. And we're going to see Volunteer Lawyers for the Arts, where I work.
Macy, where are we?
We're in Times Square, right in the heart of Manhattan, where all your Broadway shows are, where a lot of the big companies and their buildings are, including mine. So we're gonna go see my workplace. I work at Volunteer Lawyers for the Arts and their legal fellow for this year, which is like an interesting position. A fellowship is something that people sometimes do after law school, and it's like for a set time. And usually for a specific reason, like they have it with judges, or I don't know, it just kind of depends. So I'll be here for 9 months, and then I'll be
back on the job search. Excited to look again.
The hair's going crazy.
I know, it's windy today. So this is where I work at Volunteer Lawyers for the Arts, right in the middle of Times Square. There's so much energy coming here every day. Like, every time I get off the train, I'm like, I'm in New York City. I'm going to work in New York City. It's wild. We do a lot with copyright. There's disputes between artists. Sometimes we have people that call in and say, somebody stole my song, or my artwork was destroyed, and I need help getting help with that. I need, you know, I need help protecting my work. And we're able to provide that help. We look at how much money the artist is making, and if they make below a certain threshold, we are able to assist them generally by hooking them up with a pro bono attorney. What that means is the attorney is doing the work for free. And so we are a referral service to the attorneys in our network, and we'll link them with artists that need assistance, and they're able to help for free.
Gotcha. So, Macy, when you were here, what did your day look like when coming to this office?
Every day can be different, of course, because we get so many calls. So what usually happens is I'll come into the office, and pretty early on the phone will start ringing, or we'll start getting emails from artists that need assistance. Then we'll do intake, or I'll talk to them about what they need assistance with. I'll let them know if it's something we can help with. That's usually how the day starts. At least once a week, we have what's called a clinic, which means that we will be assisted by a firm in New York City, generally in New York City, and they will have a call with our possible clients to see if they can answer their question in just one sitting, or if it's something that will need more assistance in the future. So it could be a question about copyright, like, am I allowed to use this cartoon in my work? And the lawyers will be able to say yes or no, or maybe, or determine what the risk is of them using that character. Or it could be something as far as somebody's stolen my work and is saying it's theirs, and that might be something that has to go to court. So it really could be as short as one day having one conference with a client and figuring their issue out, or it could go into many months, even years.
And so, I mean, we're in this beautiful city, right? So what can an associate expect when working at a firm that's like, I mean, or not a firm, but...
So I'm specifically at a nonprofit organization, which means that I am not an associate. I am a legal fellow, and that means that it's for a certain time. I have many different cases on that I'm working on every single day. So I probably have a wider variety of things that I'm working on, but, you know, at a firm, they can have a wide variety of cases as well.
Gotcha. And so while you were here, what did your, like, typical day look like? Was it, you know, sometimes you were at home, most of the times you're in the office?
With COVID, it's changed a little bit. We have Fridays that we work remote, which is awesome. Even though I really love going into the office, I like the buzz and being able to go into somebody's office and ask a question right when I have it. But so yes, usually we're in the office, and we do a lot of Zoom calls because of COVID. It used to be that people and possible clients would come into the office and talk with us directly, but since COVID, it's done much more by phone, email, and Zoom.
And so would you say most of the lawyers are doing, like, work by themselves or with a team? And, like, are you more of a team player, or you there's an I and win type of gal?
No. For what I'm doing right now, at least at the nonprofit, it is very much so all hands on deck. We have so many clients that need assistance that we are helping each other as much as we can, getting many calls, many emails. So if I have to write a memo of something that happened, I might go to this boss, but I also might help with intake with this boss. And I definitely work with almost everybody in the office, including our large number of interns. We have a lot of interns from Columbia this year and a lot from Cardozo, which is where I went to school.
Gotcha. And so to wrap up, being at your office, what would you say, like, your most proud project is?
My most proud project so far, or what I'm proud of the most, is whenever we get to close a case, which means that we saw it the whole way through. We assisted from the beginning, and the client never had to pay for that legal assistance. And nothing feels better than when I get to go in to our sales force and click close case, and we handled it, and the client's in the clear and got all the answers that they wanted. I've only been here for 2 months now, so usually things take a bit longer than that. I've only gotten to press close a few times, but the few times that I have been able to has been so rewarding, and it's what keeps me coming back.
Perfect. And so where are we going now?
Now we can go to Atlantic.
Atlantic Records, and let's go.
We just finished with Atlantic Records, but Macy just brought me to this crazy place.
Junior, it's really your quintessential New York diner and just a really good place to go that I like to bring everybody when they first come to New York.
So to get at a company like Atlantic Records, was that because of, you know, your school, your resume, your personal statement like you had mentioned earlier?
All of it.
Okay.
They definitely liked that I had worked in music before and had other internship experience as well as my own experience as an artist. I think that was something that spoke to them. I mean, every time you apply for a job, I have to write another cover letter, right? So I explained why I wanted to be there. But the opportunity itself, I found through the school. So Cardozo has a lot of alumni that work in music currently, and they have a really strong network. And so I guess somebody from Atlantic had told Art Career Services to put that on our internship site, and so that's where I found it. So definitely have to give credit to Cardozo, but still had to go through the interview process on my own and explain why I had the credentials to be there.
Cool. So with that being said, like, what would be your favorite project when doing those types of cases or doing those types of helping?
So of course I can't name names or specifics because client attorney confidentiality.
Yeah.
You always got me there, Devin. But some of my favorites have been, you know, music's just like my language. So of course I love to see music cases come through, especially when artists need to know who owns the rights to what. And I really like figuring out who owns what part of the music. This is just kind of a side note, but something that's interesting in music law is that every song that you hear doesn't just have one copyright, it actually has two. One is the composition itself, which I like to think of as sheet music, who owns the music as it is written down. And then there's the sound recording, which is what you hear on the radio, on streaming, and that's the artist and musician's performance of that work. So with having those two different copyrights, there can be questions of who owns what. And also, AI, artificial intelligence, has really changed and is continuing to change the laws and the art, because people will make something through AI and it's like, well, does the computer own that? Or the person who put in the formula? And honestly, courts are still figuring it out. So it's cool to be on the cutting edge of that.
So we just got back from going out in New York City, but we're back in your apartment. And so I just want to like let the audience know what other tangibles are there when like moving into New York City. Because I know you were telling me some stories that weren't as convenient as you would have liked. So kind of just explain that.
One of the first things I learned about moving to New York City is you cannot start looking for apartments until about 2 weeks out, like 2 weeks before you're ready to move. You're planning on moving?
That's
yes.
Crazy.
Because they'll be gone. The apartments that you're looking at will be gone. It's like a very quick turnover. So it's not even worth looking before then. The other thing that I learned is specifically in this apartment, it's a 5-story walk up. And so I was like, how am I going to get furniture into this apartment? And the stairs are very narrow. Turns out the girl who lived here before me was having the same problem in reverse, wondering how she was going to get all of her stuff out. Mm-hmm. So I just bought her stuff. Oh, and it worked out like pretty nicely. Yeah, this was her couch. And she already had the TV mounted. And I believe the bed was hers. And so, really, we kind of, like, did a deal with each other that, like...
That's convenient.
Yes. Yeah. Luckily, we kind of knew each other beforehand. It was a really funny story of, like, her sister was in my sorority in Nashville. Mm-hmm. So, it was somebody I, like, trusted and, you know, all that good stuff. But, that really worked out nicely, having my furniture in here.
I don't know how this, like, shit got in here. I really don't.
I have no idea.
She's right. Like, the stairs, I don't even know how you can get a suitcase up there.
Seriously. They must have, like, brought the boxes up here and built it in the apartment.
We are no Bob the Builder. We don't do that one.
No.
What other things, you know, you had mentioned that you had gotten injured and, you know, you're crutching in the snow.
Yes.
Going to school and just like kind of tell us how that journey was.
Yeah. I tore my ACL 2 years ago skiing and then got ACL surgery. Mm-hmm. And I had to be on crutches for like, I think it's like a 6-month recovery period. So I came back to New York. I got my surgery done back at home in Houston.
Don't get injured in New York.
Cause... No, because no, your life will be put on pause. I just had to leave for everything that I did like an hour early so I could crutch down the stairs and then crutch through the streets of New York to my law school.
In the snow.
In the snow. Yeah. Thank goodness I didn't fall again. I mean, like, and tear my other ACL, but... It's interesting, like, getting hurt here is not easy. Like, eventually you have to put some money towards Ubers and that kind of stuff. But take my advice, yeah, don't get hurt here.
Yeah, and then it could fuck up your finances because you're planning, you know, month to month. And
yes.
Now you're Ubering every day, so it's like...
Yeah, and how could I take the subway, exactly. You know? Or crutch down more stairs, but that was not going to be easy.
For sure.
And nobody's gonna wait for you, you know. In New York, nobody's like, oh,
They didn't wait for me today.
Right.
At the airport, they didn't give no fucks about me. But that's pretty much it. So, guys, we'll catch you with some of Macy's friends the next time we see you. The next time this transition cuts, but we're gonna go somewhere to eat, and then what else?
Hopefully, we're gonna go out.
Hopefully we can go clubbing. That would be fun.
Mm-hmm.
So show some dances. Show what we got.
I want to see what you got.
Salsita, bachata, merengue, cuanto quieres.
Oh, okay.
So we can run it for sure. But until then, we will see you guys.
'Alright guys, so we're at Philippe Chow, per Macy's request, and the hottest spot in New York. This is my sister JJ.
Hello, I finally made it to the vlog.
Yes, of course. And then we got Macy joining us for dinner. We've got a lot on the agenda tonight.
She's enjoying the drinks.
How is JJ?
So good.
We'll be chilling here for a while. Hopefully we can get some music in it. Because Macy said there's a surprise. For now, but
we'll see what it is.
What's your
Insta doing?
Like it here?
I love it.
Oh yeah.
And then hopefully that'll be good.
Are you from the city?
We're all from Houston, but I've been here for 5 years.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh,
well,
we were in Houston last year. Yeah. We liked it.
Now they're living in Austin. So oh, like we're from Houston.
Okay. Where are you guys originally from?
Oh, really?
of us.
Yeah.
Am I crazy?
We're about to grub. We're grubbing.
Big grubs.
Big grubs.
Oh, yeah. How do I even get these over? Some bun. Look at the bun, too.
Oh, that will take you to
Brooklyn.
Rogers. So that's a wrap. Me and Mace, JJ included, the whole gang pulled up today. So we had a great time.
I hope you fun. Too much fun. Too much
too
fun.
Much.
Too much fun. I hope you guys got something from Macy so that you can, you know, take it into your field. But I hope you guys enjoyed. Thank you again for your time. I know you have a busy schedule, a lot on your plate, but you took the time to, you know, share it to the other people that are trying to get involved. So I just appreciate that. So
anytime.
So
come back again.
We might have to do a part two. So if you have any other further questions, I'll be here in August.
And we'll do it again.
Thank you guys for watching. I appreciate you guys. Ask Macy some questions in the comments, and she'll be happy to answer them. But
absolutely.
Thank you.